Penguin Random House Audio presents Custer's Trials, A Life on the Frontier of a New America, by T.J. Stiles. Read for you by Arthur Morey. To my parents, Dr. Clifford and Carol Stiles, to my late mentor, Richard Maxwell Brown, and most of all, to my daughter, Sasha. And how much he suffered merely to appear in his own eyes what he wished to be. Leo Tolstoy, The Raid. Preface. The story begins with its ending. On June 25, 1876, George Armstrong Custer led the 7th U.S. Cavalry Regiment to the Little Bighorn River in the Montana Territory, where Lakota and Northern Cheyenne warriors surrounded him and a detachment of more than 200 troops and slaughtered them to a man. Renowned as Custer's last stand, it was the greatest defeat inflicted upon the U.S. Army in the late 19th century Indian Wars. Like John Hancock's signing of the Declaration of Independence, it is the one fact about the man that lives in American memory. For generations of writers about Custer, death defined his life. Since none of the soldiers who accompanied him on his final ride lived to tell about it, his annihilation has been a great mystery. The mechanics of his last battle have been analyzed and supposed in extreme detail in order to solve it. Every accident in his life, every choice, every personality trait has been interpreted in terms of how it led here. In most books, he appears as a man on the march to the Little Bighorn, or a glorified corpse thereafter. Death has defined his significance as well. His personal end brought to a climax a defining narrative of American mythology and American guilt, the conquest and dispossession of the native peoples of this continent. His personal moral character has stood in for the moral character of the United States. As the cultural consensus has shifted, the image of Custer in national memory has changed from champion of civilization, who died to tame the savage wilderness, to arrogant murderer and land thief. Custer has been shorthand for hubris, ignorance, and had it coming, Timothy Egan observed in the New York Times on November 30, 2012, but in earlier decades, Custer was a hero. Well said. Though Egan might have specified hubris with regard to American Indians, a hero on the Great Plains. For posterity, Custer's death seals him into the single role of frontier soldier. We remember him as a man of one region, the West, and one conflict, the Indian Wars. The judicious Robert M. Utley devoted all but 20 of the 209 pages of narrative in his seminal biography, Cavalier in Buckskin, to the frontier years. That's fair enough. The Little Bighorn was a landmark event, and Custer played a high-profile role in Western history. And much of the writing about him has been very good, whether by Utley, Evan Connell, Richard Slotkin, Paul Hutton, Shirley Leckie, Jeffrey Wirt, Louise Barnett, or others. I also greatly respect the researchers with no other credentials than their passion, who have uncovered a wealth of information. Fascination with Custer is such a phenomenon that there is a fascination with the fascination, as seen in Michael Elliott's fine book, Custerology. I did not write this book as a rebuttal or because previous work is substandard. Rather, I want to change the camera angle, to examine Custer's life as it was lived in order to better grasp the man, his times, and his larger meaning. If we can escape the overshadowing preoccupation with his death, a critical fact stands out. He captured the American imagination long before the Little Bighorn, even before he went west. That means he had a significance independent of his demise. But mere chronological balance is not enough. Other worthy books emphasize his earlier role in the Civil War, when he first won national attention. I am telling his story in a particular light, with a particular sense of context. The result, I hope, is not simply an addition to a familiar story. He was famous for this as well as for that, but something larger and more comprehensive. I want to explain why his celebrity and notoriety spanned both the Civil War and his years on the frontier, resting on neither exclusively, but incorporating both. Something was going on in the country that included the Civil War, westward expansion, and much more. Something about the man resonated with Americans as they experienced it. He caught the public imagination because his life spoke to that something. The search for this unifying theme is complicated by the astonishing number of roles he played. How do we reconcile the buckskin-clad outdoorsman and Indian fighter with the Midwesterner, college graduate, and professional writer? Or the battlefield emancipator with the avowed white supremacist? The widely admired military professional with the malefactor who was court-martialed twice in 6 years? The loyal friend, loving brother and son, and devoted husband with the oversensitive, sarcastic gambler who craved attention and intrigued with other women? Then there was the entrepreneur, political partisan, and urbane theater lover. How do we integrate all these conflicting parts? It is not news that he was contradictory, but we have to grasp the nature of his contradictions to see the man in his totality and understand his significance for the public of his day. Getting at them requires a fresh look at the intimate details of his life, but also a new sense of context. We must see him less in terms of place than of time. George Armstrong Custer lived on a chronological frontier even more than a geographical one. He and his contemporaries experienced the greatest wave of change ever to strike American society, a tsunami that ripped out and reordered everything. This is what his life spoke to, wherever he went. This moment is when the modern came. The emerging new order was industrial, corporate, scientific, and legal, diminishing the individualistic, the romantic, and the heroic in American culture. The rise of impersonal institutions, governmental bureaucracies, and national markets began to overshadow everything local, traditional, and customary, imposing organization, rationalization, standardization, and centralization. Such a brief description sounds overly schematic because it is. America has never been locked into a steady state, but has always been dynamic. Even before Custer's birth, the public embraced the rowdy marketplace, celebrating its virtues of competition and entrepreneurship as the spirit of go-ahead. Monetary transactions already edged in among traditional relationships of Southern master and slave, or the Hudson Valley gentry and his tenant farmers. Nepotism and personal patronage would linger long after the rise of the corporation and professionalization. A dust cloud obscures any historical movement. Clear distinctions blur on close inspection. Yet Custer's contemporaries felt themselves caught in a great transformation. The antebellum economy of personal relationships, of independent merchants, artisans, and farmers, had provided the basis for Jacksonian laissez-faire populism and the Republicans' free labor philosophy. During Custer's adult life, Americans saw themselves falling under the shadow of capital, concentrated in gigantic corporations. Before the war, working for hire was seen as only a temporary stage on the way to working for oneself. By 1868, writes the historian Heather Cox Richardson, the ideal of self-sufficiency began to give way to the reality of a permanent class of wage earners. The nation's informal, improvised quality. Lincoln was a self-taught lawyer. Faded as large institutions and expanded government bureaucracies rationalized their operations and professionalized their staff. Inherited distinctions, particularly the distinction of race, were dismantled in law, if not in effect, replaced with at least technical equality. Taken together, all this looks like the birth of modernity. This wave of change defies the impulse to tell a story of good versus evil. The Civil War slaughtered 750,000 people and devastated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.